Today, I'm going to show you how to record VoiceOver directly into DaVinci Resolve in 5 easy steps. Now, step 1, just make sure that the operating system sees your microphone. Let's take a look over here. I am on a Mac, and up in the header bar, there's a little speaker icon, right? And we go down to sound settings down below. And once that's open, you've got an output, input section. We're concerned about the input part. Okay, I'm using a Universal Audio Volt 2, but it could be a Scarlett, it could be a Blue Yeti, whatever your mic is, make sure you're actually seeing levels right here with that selected. Now, let's open up DaVinci Resolve and move to step 2. Oh, by the way, everything is chapter marked on here, so you can just skip around if you already know some of these basics. But step 2 is all about where are we saving our files and what are we calling them? What are they automatically going to get named? Over here in Resolve, we have a little project setting, a little gear icon down in the far right down there. So we're going to click that, and this is where we're going to be able to control on a per project basis where we're saving media that we generate. And that's done under the Capture and Playback tab. With Capture and Playback tab, there is an area under Capture called Save Clips To. This is the important part of where you're actually saving your clips to when you're recording audio in here. You just click Browse, and you have the option here. Obviously, this is going to my Movies folder, but you could set this to, maybe a good idea would be for this to go straight to a job folder with all your assets in one single folder, which makes it easy to archive. But we'll just leave that in this Movies folder area for today. And so now you know where that is. That's where they're going to be written to and linked to when you're creating the media. Let's hit Cancel. And now where are the files actually going in the project? We know we're going on disk. Let's create a bin by right-clicking and saying a new bin, call it VO for VoiceOver. And that just gives us a place for them to land. So whatever bin you're inside of, we're in this master VO bin, when it's writing the files, it's gonna place them in whatever bin is selected. So if you have a giant project, lots of bins, choose the bin first, then record your VoiceOver. All right, now we have to actually have a place to write the files to. And you do that by creating a timeline in Resolve, and that's pretty easy. You right click here. If you don't really know, just right click and Resolve, create a new timeline, and we could just call it VO. Now, here's something I want to point out. The audio track type by default is going to be stereo. That's normally what most people need. But for voiceover work, you really just have one mouth. So your audio track type should be mono. That means it's like a single channel. So I'm going to go back over here and choose mono and click create, and I'll zoom back out. And we're almost ready to go. Now, the next thing I want to show you, I've never really seen taught much, and it's a really nice feature. So if you go to the Fairlight tab, and let's see our everything nice and big. So if you hold down Shift and then the scroll wheel, it makes everything nice and tall. And we can get rid of this bus down here. We don't need to see that by clicking this button. So this is the big tip here I want to show you. If you click on Audio 1, instead of that being called Audio 1, call this something unique, and this is actually part of the file name that gets written to the hard drive. So today is the 6th of January, so I'm gonna just type in 240106, and then something that is useful, like probably the person's name. So I'm Chadwick, by the way, welcome if you're new here for the first time. If you're not, I'm so thankful that you would watch a second video of mine, but let's just click okay now, and we're all set up. And so that's the end of step 2. We know where they're going to be saved on disk, we know where they're going in the project, and we know what they're going to be called. Oh, and remember, VoiceOver is mono. Now let's patch the microphone into the timeline. That is done only on the Fairlight page that I'm aware of. And you go over here to our track that you want to be writing to, which is going to be A1, okay? And what I'm going to do is just click on that and choose input. And we have a couple options. There's not a lot of timeline stuff going on here. So basically the right side is the destination, which is the timeline, and the left side is our audio inputs. And I'm going to choose Volt 1, Volt 2. And that's because the device that I'm actually plugged into over here has two audio inputs, and I'm plugged into channel 1 of it. So I want to take 1 and plug that directly into my track 1, which we had already renamed in the last step to today's date with a name. We're going to hit patch, and so those are patched. Now, the next thing you're going to want to do is mute your output. So even if you left your speakers on, this is a good time to turn this button right here. This is your output to your speakers. Turn that to mute, so that you're not getting a feedback loop from your speakers back into your microphone that could be in the same room. You're not gonna want that. And we're gonna be arming our track, which is this button right here, arm for record. And as soon as you do that, you can see We have levels right here on our screen. Now, I'm going to show you how I professionally gain stage a microphone so that you never have to worry about clipping or 32-bit audio. If we take a look back over here at my screen, we have our audio meters are bouncing because we have that armed for record available, so it's hearing our microphone. And down here, you can actually see the numbers, right? There's a minus 20, minus 15, minus 10. People will tell you all these different things. You should record at minus 6 to 12, or, you know, there's all these different numbers being thrown out there. It's actually really, really simple. For a voice going into a microphone, no matter where it is, you should really be peaking around minus 18, and that's when that line turns yellow. So on your device, if you have a device that has a gain knob, I'm going to show you what this is like if I turn it up and I keep turning it up and up and up. This is where some people will tell you to record your audio. The reason you don't want to do this is if I get excited, you can see how quickly that starts to clip. Where you want to be setting this, honestly, is you keep turning it down and down and down until you're just kissing that yellow line from your normal speaking. So honestly, as a professional, from me to you, set your audio levels so that they peak around minus 18, and you're going to save yourself so much headache from clipped audio, and you just turn it up afterwards in step 5. And then step 4 is simple. You just hit record. That's this button right here. But before you do that, you might want to take a look up in the keyboard customization area up here. There is actually a command for record. So you can assign this to your own keyboard customization. I personally have this set, and it's Fairlight Record if you just search for record. Command Shift R, you know, it's a mnemonic, record. It's an easy one for me to remember. That's what I do. So maybe that will be helpful. Let's start recording. Command Shift R. And there it goes. It's starting to record our voiceover file. So there was a lot of setup to this, but I promise you that this gets faster and faster as you do this more often and you realize where things have gone wrong. I broke this into 5 steps because I always start with the microphone into the computer. Then it's like, where is it going? What is it being called? And then we got to gain stage that mic. And that's the reason I do that inside of DaVinci Resolve is because we have these meters here. I will point out, if you do not have a USB microphone, that is often controlled in system settings. So if it's a USB mic, there'll be a slider somewhere over here to turn that up and down. That's where you want to be changing that if that's the case. But hopefully you can get a microphone that has an actual physical dial on it or an interface like this Volt 2 that I like to use. We have plenty of voiceover recorded. So to stop it, you could hit the stop button right here. Or again, use your keyboard. I'd use Command Shift R to start recording. Spacebar stops it. Now check this out. The file that we just created is right here. It's in the bin that was selected like I promised you it would be. And if you want to find it on the disk, you can right click on it and say reveal in Finder. And look at this. It created a file with today's date on it, with my name on it. And if we go up levels, now here's a Mac Finder trick. If you're in this list view, which is the best view, by the way, you hit Command up. It basically created a folder. Look at this. That is the exact name of the project. So that extra organization that Resolve does in the background based off of your project name is really helpful if you forget to set it directly to your project folder that should have all your assets together. So you made it to step 5, processing the audio. This actually isn't hard at all anymore because there's some new tools that Blackmagic Design has in DaVinci Resolve. And I'm gonna show you those because I've never gotten to show them before and it's actually my preferred way of working. So let's take a look. Over here, we have audio that was recorded perfectly great, but it's obviously it's going to be a little bit low to deliver. So let's take a listen. I'm going to get rid of this mute.
Oh, that's a big thing.
As soon as I click that, we get feedback. Click this button first next time, and you won't have that feedback, okay? You want to disarm, then turn those back on. Then you don't get those weird loops. Let's take a listen to a little segment of it and look at the meters before we process. So there was a lot of setup to this, but I promise you that this gets faster and faster as you do this more often. There you go. So we're not as loud as we probably want to be for YouTube. And up here in the upper right, we have these loudness meters. I've talked about this a lot before, but there is a new addition in here called the YouTube presets, which is going to be helpful if you put stuff out online. The YouTube preset is basically negative 14 lufs and negative 1 decibel true peak. Why this really matters is it just gives you a way of playing and listening to the loudness over time, like an average over time, because this is actually what's always important for broadcast and delivery. These over here are just going to tell you if you're clipping. This is this section up here, this loudness area and this controlled true peak. This is the real thing that matters. So there was a lot of setup to this, but I promise you that this gets faster and faster as you do this more often, and you realize where things have gone wrong. We had negative 13.1 means we had 13 decibels of headroom available. So the first thing I would always suggest you do is open the inspector. And when we open the inspector, we see nothing because we have nothing selected. I'm going to choose this track right here. And on the track level, I'm going to use these two new tools that are here. There's one called Voice Isolation and one called Dialogue Leveler. I believe on the free version, you won't have Voice Isolation, but you have it. If you have it, it's great because what this does is it removes background noise. So I have like fans going on in here. So put this on, turn it down to, 30 or so. It's a little bit aggressive and it'll just clean up the background and then apply the Dialogue Leveler. And this is the big key thing that I want you to take away is the Dialogue Leveler. It's kind of like a compressor, but it's actually very, very intelligent in how it works and detects things. It's basically going to lower the peaks and it's going to raise the soft parts for you. And the presets that they've kind of built into the software are so good that I don't really bother much with dealing with applying my own compression anymore. This does a fantastic job. So I turn off background reduction because I'm also applying voice isolation, which gets rid of the background noise. And I'm going to choose the option for optimize moderate levels. This, I've done a lot of testing. This gets things flattened out to a point where it doesn't sound bad, but there's still a really consistent volume. So you can play things on things like a phone and that or speakers that don't have a lot of power, and you can hear them even in the subway. And the way that I would process the audio next after this is actually to normalize it. But here's the thing. If you are creating a normalization for YouTube, you'll have a whole lot of different tracks. So don't do this on a clip-by-clip basis. Instead, create a mix down and apply normalization to that. Let me show you how that works. So with a track selected, you can go up to timeline, bounce, mix to track, okay? What this is doing is it's gonna take all the effects that are on that track, which we had voice isolation and dialogue leveler with optimized moderate levels. Remember that over there? That's basically my settings I'm using most of the time. And then we're gonna choose our destination to be bounced to a new track. And this is gonna be a stereo track because this is gonna be for like a final output. Click okay. And it goes through your entire timeline. So this will include, your music that you mix, sound effects, all that sort of stuff, not just your voiceover. So let's say you have a podcast with like two people, use those dialogue levelers. It's gonna put them in, you can get them in the same ballpark, and then use this for your final mastering. You can see it has actually taken some of the dynamics out of the voice. So it's made the louder parts quieter and the quieter parts louder, in addition to getting rid of that background noise, which is that studio feature called the voice isolation. So let's take a listen to that now. And the way you would do that is you would mute the, or you could just, actually you could just, if you wanted to, you could just solo. If you had lots of tracks, you could just solo the new one. Take a listen. So there was a lot of setup to this, but I promise you that this gets faster and faster as you do this more often. And you realize where things have gone wrong. I broke this into five steps because I always start with the microphone into the computer. Then it's like, where is it going? What is it being called? So that obviously that leveled things out. So there's not as much dynamics, but it's not loud enough. So this is where you apply the normalization. Check this out. Over here, you just select your clip, you right click it, you say normalize audio levels. YouTube's a good option for anything online. Click normalize. And catch this, don't misunderstand what normalize does. What normalize does is it brings all of your levels up to the same amount. There's no dynamics applied. It is either hitting negative 1 decibels true peak or the target loudness of negative 14. I don't think you're ever going to hit the target loudness of negative 14. So it's basically saying it's going to hit a target loudness of negative 1 decibel true peak. It's going to find the highest peak, bring all of it up an even amount so that it's hitting that negative 1. Now over here in your inspector area, you'll see the volume has been turned up to 10.9. So basically it had 10 decibels of headroom. That's like perfect. It's not pushing the audio file too much because this is a 24-bit audio file. It has lots of dynamic range, even though they'll tell you you always got to use 32-bit float on YouTube now. 24-bit is actually really, really good. Now you've got that voiceover much louder, so it's easy to hear on any sort of speaker, and it's not going to be clipped at all. Let's take a listen. So there was a lot of setup to this, but I promise you that this gets faster and faster as you do this more often. and you realize where things have gone wrong. I broke this into five steps because I always start with the microphone into the computer. Then it's like, where is it going? Okay, now I do want to point out one thing here. Our integrated level is still not all the way up to negative 14, negative 15, negative 16, where you probably want to eventually get. Honestly, voice like this, I think negative 16 is probably a good spot, negative 17. So what we do to pull this up one step further, this is the last little final touch in processing. I'm not going to be sending this out. You could kill this with a Command D, or I have a K for kill. Just mutes the clip so you're sure it's not going to go out anywhere. And then in the effects area over here, you can click your effects, dynamics, Fairlight effects, limiter, okay? This is a great effect to apply at the end to protect yourself and still increase your level. So instead of using the faders, I don't use the faders in here, I use the limiter effect, set the ceiling to -1 because that's as loud as we want it to go for YouTube or really anywhere for decibels true peak. And then under the input, we kind of get an idea of where how much we can actually add to this to get us where we want to be. Well, -19 up here, and we want to go to -14, that would be 5 decibels. This loss is the same as a decibel for all purposes here. But if you look here, we have a -4.6 true peak. So I don't want it to get super close to there. So what I might do in this situation, I would add 3 decibels, and that's going to get us to a great spot. So that's the input is going to be adding 3 decibels, okay? Actually, you can probably just click in there. Yeah, and just type 3. And this soft button makes it a little bit less harsh on the processing getting turned on and off. We know it's on because this orange thing is turned on. And we take a listen to another segment again. And let's reset our meter, start it again, hit, you know, spacebar to play. And you realize where things have gone wrong. I broke this into 5 steps because I always start with the microphone into the computer. Then it's like, where is it going? What is it being called? And then we got to gain stage that mic. And that's the reason I do that. Okay. And you can see we have an integrated loudness level of -16.3. That is awesome. That is super good for anything you need to send online that is like spoken word, like a tutorial. I might have said in the past to go louder than that, but honestly, when you go to -14, -15, it gets super crunchy compressed sound. So I would not advise that. You can know if you're pushing it too hard. Let me zoom into here and push play. If you're going across this blue line much inside of DaVinci Resolve, is because we have these meters here. I will point out, if you do not have if you have a USB microphone, the goal really is to be kissing this line and only going over it in like rare circumstances. Otherwise, your audio is gonna sound crunchy and not great. Please let us all know down in the comments how you process audio. And because there's so much more to learn, I'll see you in the next video.